Now that we have established neither of us is wearing a pantsuit or a sari, so we can get on with it. Just wanted to first thank you, thank the organizers and the audience for this opportunity. This is my first time at the, is it okay?
Yeah.
Right. This is my first time as a speaker at the Lit Festival. It's a great honor. Feeling a little shaky, so I'm sure you'll all help me get through this. I enjoy the process of writing. I love making up that little conflict that would eventually grow into a plot, a storyline. I like to think about what my characters would do. Research gives me immense pleasure, and I'm also interested in human behavior in general. Gayatri is a good friend of mine, but apart from that, she's also a behavioral science specialist. And oftentimes we talk about human behavior, perceptions that, the perceptions that you, how you perceive me as soon as you look at me, as soon as you see my gestures, all of that is of interest to us. So when I got this opportunity, I thought it would be fun to have this conversation with Gayatri. And kind of talk about it in the context of characterization and bring you all into listening as well as participating in this conversation. I'm sure you all have stuff to contribute as well.
Yeah. Right? So great vibes here. I'm very happy to be with other novel addicts here, aspiring writers. Yes, there we are.
Right.
Good to know you all. I think let's start by establishing what characterization is. I mean, I don't know what other people perceive, so I thought it's good to know what you perceive as characterization and where do you go from there?
Yeah, I mean, Gayatri is known to pose tough questions at me, and she's told me she will not reveal the questions. So that was a condition she put to come here. So I'm going to have to think about some of the questions. I think there are two parts to characterization. First of all, creation of the character in my head as a writer, and then the representation of it. So when I talk about the creation of it, I mean I get inspired by standard archetypes that, most they say there's only so many plots,
12.
And there is only so many characters or archetypes, right? So I would get inspired from that. I still don't have the age or the guts to accurately represent someone I know very well. So I only take a little bit of people that I know, and then I know some of it is purely my imagination. So that's kind of how I draw inspiration for my characters. And it's not very sequential. It's not something that before I begin my novel, I have everything clear in my head. I know exactly who this person is. It's not that clear. Mm. Sometimes as I write the novel, as I proceed, I sometimes go back and refine the character, and I get to know the character a little bit. And so that's sort of the creation of, when I say characterization, that's that creation part of it. And then there's the representation part of it, where I feel like, as I write the novel, I'm getting to know the characters a little more. Mm. So as a reader, I want you to know the characters a bit more. And for me, the biggest success is if you can tell me by the end of the book how, for an event that is not in the book, if you can tell how the main characters are going to react or if you know a little bit about them, then that, I think, is a success for me as a writer. And that's the kind of books that I enjoy reading as well, where I kind of know how this character is going to behave. It's much easier when you have like a series, when you have that kind of a canvas that you can develop the character over a series of books. And obviously it's much harder for a short story. You just have a brush stroke to establish a character. Novels are a little bit okay in between. You have some space to establish the character, some time to develop the character. So to me, characterization is, by the end of it, both you and I, as a writer and a reader, should get to know this person. You should be able to understand this person. You might not agree with that person. In fact, one of my friends said, Uma, who's the protagonist in the first book, was thoroughly irritating, and that, you know, it's very annoying behavior, right? So it's not that you have to like the character, or you don't even have to agree with the character, but, you know, you should get her. You should know. Yeah, I mean, this is, yeah, it makes sense that this character would behave in this fashion. So that, to me, is characterization, and that, to me, is like a successful characterization.
So how do you get to share what you see in your mind's eye of, say, Uma or Josh of your second book? What do you want the reader to see as a character? And how do you, like, you know, movies have this opening scene and the protagonist arrives. Is there some such plan that you have? I mean, starting from the name, I mean, why Uma? Why Josh? I mean, why not Renuka or, you know, Peter?
Yeah, I mean, honestly, I don't think I thought a lot about the characters' names. Mm. Uma was kind of it was simple enough, and you know, it's a most of the other 18th century names that I could think of were really long, and my great aunt's names were all really long and complicated.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
And Uma was you know, small enough, but it, I mean, you know, short enough, and it also was is old enough, and there are some connotations in which I kind of, I don't know if it's the name that caused me to get those put those traits in her, or it's vice versa, but it also is like, you know, she's somewhat courageous, oh, and you know, she's a go-getter. So those things sort of made
yeah,
sense.
Yeah.
Now Josh is actually a conscious decision. It's from Joshua, who's a biblical character, and Moses sends Joshua to do certain some things, and that's kind of the connotation for choosing the name, yeah, Josh. And I also like the sound of that name, so
yeah,
so
yeah,
that's the other thing.
So your two books are set in different contexts. One is very historical. The Uma is about the Mysore wars and the rockets and things like that, without giving away the plot. It's a very interesting context that you have set. So building a character from the past, and vis-a-vis building a character contemporary, like Josh. I mean, Josh is, you know, you will probably hit a few Joshes in Bangalore on your way back home, yeah? But Uma, no. So how do you kind of give it that completeness of the character?
So, I mean, let me take a step back. So what are my tools to make you understand my characters? It's only a limited tools. Of course, I can always start by opening and saying, Josh is blah, blah, blah. You know, it's like an omniscient narrator. I can just tell you. But that's no fun in that, you know, right? The fun is when I start doing a few things where you start getting that character. So, you know, looks, the way they speak, gestures, body language, what they wear. Oh. All of these finally kind of go back to giving the complete picture. Now, I think I've used all of these in both the books. It's much easier to do it for a contemporary setting, because, you know, there's so much material out there. You know, if I wanted to know what someone would wear, it's easy. I mean, it's set in Chennai, and it's easy, and London, but there's so much material on the internet that it's easy for me to figure that out. But when it came to the 18th century, it's not so easy, and I had to go back and do it the old-fashioned way, read books.
Yeah.
There were these old paintings and, you know, descriptions, so I had to kind of draw from that. But ultimately, I think the fun is in revealing a person, and I'm sure we are all forming opinions, right? As you're listening to me, as I'm seeing you, I'm forming opinions in my head, and it's based on the way I look, based on my the way I talk, my gestures, and the word choices, all of this. So as I'm building my character, I'm going through that steps. And, you know, we can talk about some of those examples as well, or from other authors as well.
Yeah. So one scene that I'm recalling as we speak now is when Ashton gets attacked by Uma in the beginning. It was unexpected for me that he took it so calmly. I mean, for the situation that he was in, he did the wait and watch when his life was threatened. And that was the opening for Ashton. So to me, that scene, looking at it from the behavioral point of view, he said, okay, let me see where this is leading. And it could have led him to death, possibly. But somehow he kind of held his own and stood his ground and said, okay, my duty is there. I have to figure out what this is all about. What is this intrigue that's happening here? And that's the opening that kind of set the tone for Ashton. For Josh, if you compare, we're talking pantsuits now, right?
Sure, yeah.
So for Josh, it is at airport. I mean, he comes in, he's not very clear, he's tired, he would rather be elsewhere. He's kind of saying that, I don't know why I agreed. I don't know why Tom has his hold on me, that he makes me go around the world to India on a hot summer's day. Rather, I would be sitting in the Silicon Valley and enjoying California weather. Here I am trying to do. So there are these settings that you bring them to, and it gives me as a reader the sense that, okay, this is where I related to Josh, by the way. I mean, the airport scene was a great scene. I could completely kind of connect with where he was. Obviously, I've never been charged by a woman of the 18th century, so I don't know how Ashton felt, but I somehow got a sense that he seemed like a responsible person. He seemed like, I'll put duty before my own self. And somehow he also marries Uma in the end, right? I mean, that's a big step, given who, where, the time. And Uma is half Indian, half English. So all of those things. So something about him that you brought in the first space. So did you know that Ashton will marry Uma when you put this scene?
Absolutely. So yeah. As I mentioned earlier, I'm experimenting with genre fiction. I'm actually not writing general fiction. It is in my head. I'm very clear. This is my voice. I'm not going to try and do something else. And my fiction as of now, and maybe if at all I do something else completely, I would probably do it in a different name. So Radhika is someone who writes mysteries, romance, with some basic question. So that's my voice. And if you look at the first book, the basic question is about, to a large extent, about racism and prejudice, mm-hmm. and what happens when you look a certain way, but you feel a certain way. I mean, President Obama was, we think of him as the first black president, but actually he's half black.
Yeah.
But the fact that he's black makes us look at him in a certain way. Mm. And how does he feel inside? Does he feel white inside? Does he feel black inside? Or does he even, who knows, right? It's very hard. But we look at him in a certain way, and we make our impressions based on that. So the first book is actually about someone who looks very English, but her heart is completely Indian. Her heart and soul is Indian. Everyone else treats her as an English woman, but she is like, I'm Indian. Yeah. I'm Indian. That's kind of how she. So it's kind of a reverse of a lot of kids who are born in the U.S. and who look Indian but feel American or feel English. You know, the second generation Americans and Australians and so on. So how do they feel? But what do you feel inside? So the first book, ultimately, it's about that question, but within the frame of a genre fiction. Mm. So it's within the frame of, a romance. So I know they were going to get get married. I knew what the ending of the mystery was even before I started.
Okay.
In the second book, again, it is a romance, it is a mystery, but the fundamental question is about art.
Yeah.
About how someone who is a very science-oriented person, who thinks there is an app for everything, suddenly looks at an ancient art and what happens in his mind. So the journey he goes through. So that's the second book. But ultimately, because it's genre fiction, I know the ending even before I started. But to your earlier point about Ashton taking that thing, and that's where I find it was a, these things go in steps for me. So for example, Josh coming, so we talked earlier about how to represent the characters, right? So So first, attire, and how they look. So if I were to start with, for example, earlier we were talking about Poirot. The minute we say Poirot, most people would remember his mustache, how he spent so much time grooming his mustache, and
Sherlock Holmes and his pipes and cocaine habit, and
his hat and his pipe and his violin, and you have all these things that you start building into the character, and all of these little things starts making the character memorable. So for example, Josh is a geek. So, he wears a backpack. He doesn't, so when I introduce him, he wears a backpack. He's not carrying a briefcase. He's not wearing a suit. So he is wearing his hoodie and his, there's his headphones dangling from his ears and so on. But at the same time, I want to make the difference. It's not stereotypical, because I'm not trying to describe a stereotype, because Josh is not a slob who doesn't go out and exercise and only sits and
codes,
right? So he swims and he does a few other things. So it's not a stereotypical description, but you take an archetype. But my goal is to make sure you get Josh as soon as I start the first page, so that I don't have to establish a lot of, I don't need to take a lot of time to establish who he is, because then I'm going to dismantle it. I'm going to actually, through the book, I'm going to dismantle his who he is, and then get him to a certain other place. So similarly, in the second book, Vidya, the 24-year-old, I don't know if I made it 24 or 25, but
somewhere
20-something
there, yeah.
young woman who lives in Chennai. I have this couple of lines where she's going for a run, and she's wearing a track pant and a shirt, right? So, and then there's this line which kind of says she doesn't think her neighborhood is ready for her in tank tops and shorts. Yeah. So it kind of establishes her character to you. She's not pushing the envelope in her attire. It's Chennai. And she lives in a upper middle class area. And at the same time, she's not somebody who doesn't go for a jog, who's wearing a sari. So you kind of have an impression about her as you're reading that. So that's where I feel the look and those things start coming in. And same with in the first book, the fact that he takes it calmly tells you something about his character. So oftentimes writers are told to show, not tell, right? And how do you show? It's one of the most difficult things as a writer. You have to keep thinking, okay, how am I going to show this? I have to show this somehow, and I can't go and tell, right? And then you start introducing these quirks to the characters, and slowly you start using those to show. And then you start working within that. Again, lingo, traits like Ashton is constantly whistles. So the fact that he whistles and he takes things calmly, it's kind of like if I had written him, if it were a contemporary scene, I might have made him chew some gum and sit like this or something like that, So it kind of gives you an impression.
Yeah.
So somebody sitting like this and talking with a different tone gives you a different impression. So those are like I said, look, the character traits, certain even jewelry that they wear. And then the word choices when the characters speak, do I want them to be more cultured? Do I want them to be raw? All of those things start playing in.
The slang.
The slang.
Yeah, so Josh has that, right? I mean, he has that techie thing, I gotta do it. So, call up room service and things like that.
Full of himself, a little abrupt. I had to decide if I was going to use, make Josh use the F word. He's a late 20s American, but his parents are philosophers and physicists, and his brother is a
art
curator.
Historian, yeah.
And they wouldn't have approved him dropping the F word in every two words. They would have said, hey, it lowers the IQ, so don't use get a better word choice. So throughout the book, he doesn't use the F word, but then there are two scenes where something happens and he's like, you know, really upset or he's really taken aback and he does use the F word.
So what?
What the F?
yeah.
I don't know if I can actually say that. Here,
yeah.
So he does say it. So that's what I mean by word choices. But it also acts as a good counterpoint where I've established his character in a certain way, and then I push it and say, okay, he was really shocked, and that's why he's using the word to this girl, right?
So I think some other thing which I noticed is, your characters push their own boundaries. They are where they're not normally expected to be. So Ashton is in India, middle of a war. Uma, from her home, she goes off all the way to England to live. Then there's Josh, who comes to India. And then there is Vidya, who goes into metallurgy to understand. So they're pushing boundaries. And as an author, I want to bring in Tom. It's a very difficult character to bring because he is bound to the wheelchair. He has had... I don't remember exactly what his ailment is, but he's bound to the wheelchair. And I felt that there was an element of courage there as well. There is no self-pity in him. He's happy doing what he does. He's got his own expertise. He's got his own aura. Sitting where he is, he gets Josh to jump through hoops. So are you as an author pushing boundaries as well in terms of... That's a theme, right? I mean, all of them are away. Yeah,
absolutely. And I think it's a very insightful comment because I've not gone through that kind of adventure. I've not bungee jumped or I've not skydived, though I would like to do it sometime. And the archetype that appeals to me is the reluctant adventurer. Someone, if I were thrown into a situation where, I have to figure out a mystery involving a 11th century Chola idol, what would I do? You know, I'm a reluctant adventurer. I'm a couch potato. I've not been anywhere. So what would I do? So that's where most my characters are as well. They're somewhat reluctant. They're not really interested in this adventure. They just come along and then things happen to them and they develop as a character as well.
Yeah.
So absolutely. And then talking about Tom and the Maharaja in the first book, those are not the main characters, but those were the characters that I enjoyed writing. And I think it shows because I pay attention to the details a lot more, even though they are not the primary characters, and that kind of shows my attachment.
Yeah. So I remember Tom's drawl. I mean, even after so many things, so I can hear him, and that's to your credit.
Thank you.
Yeah. On that note, questions.
Hi, Radhika. It's beautiful to have you there. I have two questions to you.
Sure.
The first question is, since you've been mentioning every now and then that you would like to detail your character and the somewhere that, you know, you want to hit the right card, the right way, the right place. So basically, you know, you're going and re-scripting the character, re-scripting it again when, you know, the need be it is. So has there been any instances or times, since you also mentioned that, you know, you're a lot into researching, so has there been any times or instances where, you know, even in your dreams or, you know, you're sitting somewhere doing something and, you know, flash of a second, you get something and you just run back to, you know, where you've left writing and you say, okay, let me try to incorporate this. This is the right thing. First question. Second question is, what is Radhika's signature in the book? What do we look out for in Radhika's signature? How is she different from any other person in the same genre of writing?
To your first question, not so far as dreams yet, though who knows, in the next book it might happen. But definitely, you know, I'm in the middle of something, doing something else, and I notice something and I think, ha, okay, I want to mention this in my book. I think my character would behave in a similar fashion or in a completely opposite fashion in this situation. and this is interesting, I will pull it into my book. Definitely. There's a lot of times it's inspired by actions that, you know, that happened to me in real life. You know, a security guard that I meet, how do I greet him, how he greets me, and somebody who snubs a waiter or support staff, how would my character behave in that situation? You know, all these things keep coming back to me. So definitely I would just, I would be in this mode of thinking, okay, I have to write it. Honestly speaking, I would say for 10 such inspirations, I probably only put in 2. I would either forget 8 or it doesn't really fit in, but about 20% of the time. To your second question, I think my voice, as I said earlier, is somebody who's not completely a genre fiction writer, but who's also not in the in the extreme Tolstoy type writer. So I'm somewhere in the middle, and I think it is my personality as well. I'm somewhat of a I haven't gone through a lot of hardships, and I don't want to be dishonest and write about major troubles and all of that. I don't think I can do justice to it. But at the same time, I am a serious person. I do love, thinking about serious things and, going through some intellectual gymnastics in my head. So I would say my books are somewhat in between. So if you were to think of what my voice is, it's that taking an opinion or a strong a philosophical question, and then but dealing with it in a light way. So that's kind of my voice.
Any other questions?
Thank you for this taking this question. It's about every character or every person has blind spots, right? So as a writer, when you're creating a character, how do you think you can put the blind spots for the character? Do you want the readers to see it through the narrative that you're giving or through the setting and the reaction that the character is giving?
Yeah, it's a brilliant question because I struggle with it. Because you do want the reader to know, but not the character to not know. Otherwise, it's not interesting, right? I mean, Josh, for example, is his blind spot is that he thinks he knows everything. He thinks he solved all world's problem using his apps and devices and his networks. His clear blind spot in the beginning of the book is that he doesn't recognize any other profession, anything else other than his world, right? He doesn't recognize, but you as a reader, you have to recognize. Otherwise, you're not going to really get that fulfillment towards the end of the book. You're not going to feel like, yeah, it's a good ending because now he has matured as a person. Similarly, Uma, she has this prejudice, but she doesn't accept. I mean, she keeps giving other reasons for it. She keeps saying no, but no, but and most of the time, I have to somehow figure it out and make sure it's pushed through dialogues. It's pushed through somebody else's comment about this character, and the last resort is the omniscient narrator perspective. I try not to go all the way and put it as explicit as that, because then there's no fun in it. I mean, if you look at R.K. Narayan's Vendor of Sweets, right? In the first 2 pages, you have this character Jagan, who's talking about how he's given up rice, how he's given up sugar. He's this all healthy and ascetic and all of that, right? And then towards the 3rd page, when his cook comes and says, okay, there's a lot of jalebis left out, he says, mash it and we'll use it tomorrow. For sales, we'll use it, we'll make something else out of it and use it tomorrow. So you realize that, okay, that's his character. So there's some hypocrisy in play. There's you sort of realize. I mean, there's these masters, these writers who are masters are so good at it. But I think that's a really tough problem. And I would say I've matured as a writer in my 2nd book, and I hope to be even better at it in my 3rd book, where the blind spot is visible to the readers up front, but not to the character herself or himself.
Yeah.
Hi. Now, when you write a genre like that, do you have a specific target audience in mind? Do you also consciously make an effort that the younger generation love to read something like a character like Uma? So do you put in a lot of effort to make it appealing even though it's not a contemporary character?
I think this is a debate that a lot of, this is a question a lot of authors get asked. I would say that I have the luxury of not worrying about my target audience, and I like to write for my own sake, because I don't think I would spend months or years writing this book if it is not something that I would read. And it has to be fun. It cannot be stressful. Otherwise, I would not continue with it. It's like having a friend over the next 5 years who you're going to meet every day. You know, you better be somebody you are interested in. Otherwise, you're not going to continue with it, right? So I would say I have the luxury of not worrying about the audience and writing for the sake of writing. Other people might not, but so I don't really think about the target audience. In fact, I would say the target audience, if I were to really start thinking about it, I would be deeply worried because my books are not it doesn't fit in with specific genres, specific target audience. Now also, I've been surprised by the kind of folks who have read and commented on it. I would not have expected men to have liked my first book, but you know, I did get a lot of good comments from male readers as well. I think it's something that one should not worry about if they could.